Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents Fire Your Boss. Discover work you love without quitting your job. By Aaron McHugh. Narrated by Brian Holden. Introduction. This is the third time I've written this book. The first version was a rant. The second was a passionate sermon. And this one is a swan song. I've contemplated quitting and not finishing this version 1,000 times, but I knew you were out there waiting for a lifeline. The work you do every day is meant to make a lasting dent in the universe, but some of you don't believe it anymore, and your heart is growing weary. I suspect you picked up this book because of the polarizing title, and you were banking on me giving you some silver bullet advice on how to rid yourself of a boss forever. Sorry, pal, but this isn't a book about becoming an entrepreneur or about how to retire early. I'm offering alchemy. This is a book about how, in the day in and day out of going to work, you can learn to create irrefutable value in every workplace, regardless of circumstances. If we attempt to tackle our career challenges head on, Albert Einstein promises, no problem can be solved from the same level of consciousness that created it. But if we take a personal transformation approach of becoming the kind of person who can move from fear to freedom, blame to accountability, disengaged to engaged, powerless to empowered, compartmentalized to wholehearted, and rule follower to heretic, well then, everything can be different. Fire Your Boss is a new, liberated way of working where we learn to lead and manage ourselves, mature into wholehearted humans, and transform our work organizations from the inside out. True career liberation is an inside job, always. Together, we are starting a revolution, a gathering of ruckus-making brave souls who share a conviction about the importance of doing work we love while engaging our heart, body, mind, and soul. In other words, we want it all. We're about to embark on a journey, a road less traveled, to confront the root causes fueling our workplace unrest. But full disclosure, it isn't going to be what you think. This is not a revolution with pitchforks and torches. As I said, this is an inside job. Ready? Let's go. Chapter 1. The Big Idea. I was looking for an answer. It's the question that drives us, Neo. It's the question that brought you here. Trinity, the Matrix.
I'm gonna fire her ass!
That's what I blurted out in a weak moment of heightened frustration. I was at my wit's end. Actually, I was beyond it. I'd tried everything. Persuasive monologues, written business cases with colorful charts. I'd even hired outside consultants to help me advocate for the change I believed our business needed. But she was having none of it. No matter how compelling my pitch, she always held the veto power, and she never failed to use it. I knew there had to be a better way to secure the support I needed, earn the respect I thought I deserved, and gain permission to get the right things done. Yet, increasingly, I couldn't contain my frustrations, and the negativity from my Monday through Friday work wranglings started infecting the rest of my life. I was ready to make a change. I was ready to declare my independence. I was ready to stake a claim on my future. So, in the middle of another manic Thursday, I checked to make sure the coast was clear, then snuck down behind the bushes outside my boss's corner office picture window. There, I scooped up dirt and filled my World War II-era aluminum canister. Once safely back at my desk, I took a black Sharpie marker and labeled the canister with the company address. With my heart still pounding, I sat back with a triumphant smirk, knowing this was the beginning of my ability to move away from fear and to discover my well-deserved career freedom. The dirt in the canister idea had come to me while watching the opening scene of Saving Private Ryan. As the Allies stormed the beach, Sergeant Horvath carried a satchel of souvenir soil samples marked Italy and Africa from his successful beachhead assaults. When the D-Day bullets ceased whizzing by, he stuffed a fistful of Omaha beach sand into a new canister labeled France. That sounds ridiculous, doesn't it? Scooping dirt out of my boss's flower planter. But at the time, I held tightly to old Hippocrates' words. Desperate times call for desperate measures. Outwardly, my career looked successful, but inwardly, I was restless and longing for something I couldn't yet articulate. On LinkedIn, it would have appeared that I was happily ascending the corporate ladder and gaining influence along the way. I was leading a small team of software developers in the creation of an application that oil companies could use to price retail gasoline. I like to explain our work as similar to the movie Moneyball. Billy Beane, GM of the Oakland Athletics, brought math and science to the 100-year-old game of Major League Baseball and revolutionized it forever. Our team did something very similar with the century-old retail gasoline market. We spent 8 years creating and integrating science and technology into a solution for optimizing the best price for total profit and volume for each location across the globe. It's why you might see the price of gasoline differ by 2 cents between two competitors on the same corner. The work itself was exhilarating and innovative, but the company we worked for was quite challenging. The most illustrative story to help you appreciate the extreme frustration I was experiencing is reflected in this single quote from my boss and CEO. "People are like aluminum. When you need more, you go buy them." What she meant was that people are cheap and readily available. Without launching into 100 reasons to refute her viewpoint, I'll just say that as allies in this revolution of firing your boss, I know you appreciate how this type of thinking could create a difficult work environment. My story continued with great expenditures of emotional energy, spent arguing with owners over my bonus payment while I reached into my wallet to pay for new office chairs for employees. The company line was that the one with the broken wheel would be fine, just fine. Unclear to me at the time was the reality that I was inwardly ruled by fear and dogged by the inner voice of self-preservation. You know, that authoritative monologue that convinces us to resign our will, silence our opinions, mute our creativity, and stifle our passions in exchange for safety and predictability. That voice would tell me, "It's fine, I can take it. Tomorrow will be better. Just put your head down and get it done. You're making a mountain out of a molehill." Yeah, you know that voice too, right? I'm betting you've experienced your own version of this tension of survival and doing what is required of you, that sense of towing the company line for someone else's benefit. Unfortunately, the corporate world has its unfair share of people feeling like, and being treated like, cogs in a very cold machine. But, like you, I accepted the tension, the frustration, and the disappointment as an expected part of the package of going to work. You have stories in which the work you do, the environment you work in, the people you work with, the company message you carry, the customers you serve, and the product or service you deliver fall short of your original vision for how you'd be spending one-third of your adult life. So why do we do it? Self-preservation. We have bills to pay and families to feed, and by nature, we humans are resilient and adaptive. So we convince ourselves to stay at jobs we don't love, work with people we don't enjoy, in environments we know are toxic. Ever so subtly, we listen to our fear and tune out the pulsing reverberation of our internal compass trying to point us in a different direction. For many, work becomes the battleground of a thousand deaths. Others slowly grow deaf to their internal compasses, screaming for a course correction with each incongruous intersection of their values and actions. Eventually, they shift into a coasting gear of apathy and disengagement. I promise I'm not trying to depress you, but I also don't see any value in tiptoeing our way into the topic we have to cover: firing your boss. Back when I was scooping a soil sample out of my boss's flower planter, I lacked the language and maturity to express the higher truth that lay beyond my defiance. Yesterday over a phone call, a friend asked me, "Did you know what you were trying to accomplish in the flower bush that day?" With the benefit of hindsight, let me sum it up. Happiness and contentment are an inside job. My dirt tin was a symbolic first step of drawing a line in the sand and beginning to ignore the reactive voice of fear inside me. I'd decided to stop settling, and I started listening to my more creative beliefs and convictions about the way work could be. That moment marked the beginning of my quest to discover sustainable practices for staying engaged in my work, starting with the job I already had. I've always believed that all of us are made to feel satisfaction in meaningful work, and underneath my soil-scooping Hollywood reenactment was the desire to rediscover a healthy life. On an even bigger scale, despite my daily reality, I've always believed that I'm uniquely qualified to make a lasting contribution to the future of work. With that kind of an outlandish claim, you might expect me to whip out my long list of educational degrees from Ivy League institutions and experiences, starting with my first job out of college working in Washington, D.C. for a presidential candidate, neither of which is true. My pedigree qualification to positively impact the future of work is that I recognize patterns, invisible human patterns which elude many people. Over decades, across industries, and at countless companies, I've witnessed humans, just like you and me, wrestling to find purpose, joy, and remain engaged in their work. In small and big ways, I've always felt a sense of responsibility to be a torchbearer, illuminating the path to a more fulfilling way to experience work. I didn't know how I was going to find joy in my work again, but I couldn't shake the voice of my inner heretic convincing me there was a better way to work. Still, my daily workplace reality showed no signs of any lasting impact on the world. It was full of seemingly insignificant morsels, like taking lunchtime runs and showering in a mop closet, or debating unsuccessfully with my boss over the lunacy of researching 3 price quotes for purchasing paper clips. My own daily career narrative appeared bleak. I now appreciate how those moments were the training ground for profound, transformational shifts in the ways I began to reframe my engagement at work. The big idea. I'm going to fire my boss. I'll admit, I've always been a ruckus maker. In school, I was that kid who felt the need to constantly ask the challenging questions. Why do we have to do it that way? Or why does that rule exist? And why can't we do it this way? As I've matured, I've come to appreciate how much frustration I caused along the way. Yes, my high school principal was wrong when he told me in a closed-door confrontation, "You'll never amount to anything." But his frustration was warranted. I'd just dumped palm olive dish soap into the biology fish tanks and, along with my classmates, watched straight-faced as suds spilled out of them and the fish bobbed belly up. I'm the first to admit that I haven't always made a ruckus for the right reasons. But standing at that flower bed, I knew it was the moment of truth for my career. A worthy cause warranting a ruckus-making response. It was bigger than turning over my boss's veto power or spitefully winning arguments. This was the pivotal moment when I took ownership of my soul-level health and happiness. Fire your boss became my metaphor for transitioning from a career ruled by fear, protection, and compliance to one of authoring my own operating manual for sustainable workplace engagement and high performance regardless of my circumstances. As I write this, I'm nearly a decade beyond those neurotic moments of frustration and angst. I wish I could gift you with a single download of everything I've learned, to transform you immediately into the kind of person who can wield this new power. The problem is, information isn't as potent and permanent as transformation. I don't want to rob you of the growth and joy that will come through the struggle of creating new muscles, adopting new creative mindsets, and fundamentally changing your beliefs about your career. It's the culmination of that process that brings the ability to fire your boss and to roam the spacious, open places of freedom and creativity. Can I get an amen? If that is what you're seeking, there's a good chance you've picked up other career help books. If so, you've probably found heavy tactics and dense prescriptions and repeatable formulas. Do this, start that, create something, and you will crush it. This isn't that kind of book. My friends, you don't need more shit to do or tactics to employ. You need a heart and mindset transformation that shifts your root perspective about what's possible in your career. To that aim, I will share stories and scenes with you that represent my own transformational journey to a joy-filled, sustainable career. When I write joy-filled, I'm not talking about zippity-doo-dah endless bliss. That's not reality. I'm referring to your work being undergirded by a deep purpose and meaning that will help you get out of bed every day. Show me, an empirical data point for my analytical readers. Some of you data nerds probably aren't sure what to make of all this heart and soul talk, and you need some empirical evidence showing why the status quo corporate culture is bad for us. All right, as you wish. Gallup, a management consulting firm, is the authoritative researcher on employee engagement and well-being. They define engaged employees as those who are involved in, enthusiastic about, and committed to their work and workplace. The hard data from Gallup's Well-Being Index reports that difficult work environments and our experiences in them can negatively influence our personal wellness and health. Research that has looked at the relationship between workplace engagement and health issues over time has found substantial connections between employee perceptions of the work environment and various health problems such as coronary heart disease, inflammation, and depression. We're not crazy. The bottom line is that misery and disengagement at work carry over into our personal lives and affect our health. Coping with our incongruence. Recently, while I was leading a client culture transformation workshop in Texas, a participant spoke up to refute the importance of being engaged and passionate about the work she does. I don't know why we're all talking about engagement and passion. We aren't in Silicon Valley working for Steve Jobs. We're in oil and gas, which is not as exciting as creating the iPhone. I find it fascinating, the stories we tell ourselves to help cope with our incongruence. The gap between what we want and what we do out of obligation. Objectively, no one truly desires to work in a passionless and disengaged environment, but so many of us find ourselves downgrading our expectations and neglecting our dreams to conform to our workplace realities. Regardless of industry, role, and career season, the wisdom from the late Steve Jobs, a college dropout, if you recall, serves as a treasure map for us to discover joy-filled work. Your work is going to fill a large part of your life, and the only way to be truly satisfied is to do what you believe is great work. And the only way to do great work is to love what you do. If you haven't found it yet, keep looking. Don't settle. As with all matters of the heart, you'll know when you find it. And like any great relationship, it just gets better and better as the years roll on. So keep looking until you find it. Don't settle. Now that your heartstrings are reverberating, singing back an echoing affirmation of, "Yes, that's what I want," let's break down Steve's inspiration to extract and absorb his wisdom. 1. Because your work will fill up a large part of your adult life, it is too important and too pivotal to your life for you to be disengaged. 2. The only way to be truly satisfied is to do what you believe is great work. Only you will know when you are satisfied. No one else can define that for you. 3. You have to love what you do. You'll never be truly satisfied if love isn't driving your work. 4. If you haven't found work you love, keep looking and don't settle. Keep searching, keep experimenting and exploring. Never allow the voice of self-preservation to convince you that this is as good as it gets. 5. Your work is a matter of the heart. As such, it cannot be solved by logic alone. It is not a linear equation where every step can be plotted. It exists in a more complex, deeper part of you. You'll know when you find it, and you'll know when you haven't. Don't settle. 6. It gets better with time, like a best friendship or a happy marriage. 7. So keep looking. And in case you didn't catch it the first or second time, don't settle. I prefer taking advice from successful people, those who have achieved or obtained something I desire. We can consider Steve Jobs as one of our passionate, heretical guides on the importance of not settling, not giving up, and finding work that you love. Before I found Steve's advice and Gallup's well-being reports, I too had become convinced that there is a path leading to joy-filled work. It starts with embracing the fact that being fully engaged and passionate about the work we do is critical to our own health, wellness, and career trajectory. Work is a blank canvas where you can choose your own adventure. Work can be life-giving, fun, creative, and challenging. Meaningful work isn't going to fall from the sky into your lap. You are going to have to find it and create it. Unfortunately, there are no shortcuts. Not only are there no shortcuts, but the trail we're taking together is, unfortunately, the long way, with a signpost that reads, "The Point of No Return." Joseph Campbell, the influential mythologist, writer, and lecturer, named this transformational detour the hero's journey. Campbell says that no great story is a straight line from point A, something in my career isn't working, to point B, doing work you love with joy and vitality. Instead, every great transformational story, notice I'm not using the word average or tolerable, requires the hero, you, to go on a journey and face their figurative dragons, your internal and external fears, before they're prepared to wield their newfound badass power and insight to save the planet and defeat the enemy. In this case, to kick ass at work while charting a life-giving course of being engaged in meaningful work and making a lasting difference. Take a breath. Yes, you can do this, but it isn't going to be easy, simple, or fast. Campbell promises that heroes experience a rebirth, but it comes from a descent to grapple with their fears. Think of Mr. Anderson becoming Neo in The Matrix, or Gandalf the Grey transforming to Gandalf the White. Or, in more recent days, Carol Danvers facing her demons head-on to emerge as Captain Marvel. Here's a caveat. Not every hero succeeds. Some return home and continue the same humdrum existence they'd attempted to escape. But those brave few who stay the transformational course are reborn, equipped to face any challenge that comes their way. Take another breath. You can do this. There are some requirements for your journey. You'll need an empathetic guide, someone who knows the way and has faced similar challenges. That's me. And there are two other critical elements, a willing heart and an open mind. That means you're going to have to try unorthodox things and break a bunch of rules of conventional wisdom along your path toward transformation. But if you're willing, the rewards will be worth it. What do you think? Are you ready? A good first step might be to say it out loud, just to hear yourself say it. Get it out of your head and into the realm of reality. I'm gonna fire my boss. Chapter 2. You are the captain. I am the master of my fate. I am the captain of my soul. William Ernest Henley, Invictus. Lao Tzu wrote, "When the student is ready, the teacher will appear." Back in the middle of my depressing story, I felt stuck and trapped in my career. I was slogging through the frustrating hours, and it undoubtedly must have showed all over my being. I was more than ready. And fortunately, one of my empathetic guides appeared. After listening to a few of my depressing diatribes, a buddy gave me a copy of Hugh MacLeod's Evil Plans, Having Fun on the Road to World Domination. Evil Plans is like a Dilbert cartoon, but with more irreverence. While occupying countless bar stools in London, the author's accidental career began by sketching cartoons on matchbooks for patrons. Hugh's exaggerated satire argues that everyone needs an evil plan, a clarifying higher purpose to get out of bed every morning. Picture Dr. Evil in Austin Powers on his quest for $1 million. Now, before you get nervous that I'm about to lead you into a life of crime and potential prison time, an evil plan isn't actually evil. It may seem subversive or threatening to the status quo, but that isn't a bad thing. For MacLeod, an evil plan is a funny way of describing a path for intentionally investing your greatest strengths in order to create some greater good. Oh, and happiness results as well. His heretic gospel crescendos with a promise. You can wake up every morning feeling inspired and energized by the work you are going to do that day. This was just what I needed. Hugh helped me see that I was beating my head against the wall attempting to alter my boss's lifelong plan to be in charge and call the shots. The truth is, she never asked for help improving or revising that plan. She was perfectly happy employing minions like me to help her make another buck. I, on the other hand, was dragging my feet, feeling uninspired and succumbing to depression. Without my own vision for a better tomorrow, I burned valuable emotional energy ineffectively trying to change my boss and my company. In later chapters, I'll share with you a few zinger stories about the levels of dysfunction that triggered my internal ruckus maker. For now, the point is, no wonder I was frustrated. I had big aspirations, but I was slowly losing my grip on hope. Fortunately, Hugh was the heretic I needed to rattle my cage. His evil plans was the spark of hope that illuminated my reality and clarified these big realizations about my then-current gig. 1. The big spoiler alert is that help was not on the way. No one was coming to save me or hire me for the perfect job. 2. My boss and my company were not going to miraculously change overnight. They were perfectly content with the current system. They were not going to wake up tomorrow, grow a conscience, develop a spine, or be visited by the ghost of Christmas past to upset their cart. They loved how things worked, and they had zero plans to make things better. And 3, I was tired of my happiness being tied to outcomes I couldn't control. My only remaining choice was to reject the status quo, become the architect of my own rescue, and change my reality for good. The two-thirds and you. Not such a good scene in the American workplace. The world has an employee engagement crisis with serious and potentially lasting repercussions for the global economy. Gallup. Gallup has studied U.S. employee engagement since 2000, and repeatedly reports that roughly two-thirds of the working population is unhappy, disengaged, and not committed to their work or workplace. Globally, the numbers are worse, nearing 9 out of 10. The polls say the average U.S. employee's mindset is to spend most of their time figuring out how to avoid being productive and just trying to survive their 9-to-5 life sentence. In fact, those under age 35 are the least likely age group to say, I have the opportunity to do what I do best every day at work. Sound familiar? Raise your hand if this sounds like you. Hi, my name is blank, and it's tough out here. I'm barely hanging on. I'm struggling at work. I'm simply trying to survive. It's not that corporate America hasn't tried to make things a little better. It's that despite their best efforts to address our concerns, they've moved the needle only a little more than 1%. Most companies attempt to solve the systemic decline in our workplace morale by improving management communication, the workplace environment, and authoring better mission statements. The sad truth is that companies by themselves will never cure this epidemic and have consistently failed at inventing an antidote to our pain. Gallup's targeted inquiries drill into key questions like, does the mission or purpose of your company make you feel your job is important? In the last 7 days, have you received recognition or praise for doing good work? In the last year, have you had opportunities to learn and grow? Good questions? On the surface, no doubt. We all want to be part of a mission we believe in, be applauded for doing work, and develop personally and professionally. But there's a fatal flaw within Gallup's underlying assumption. We, you and I, are absolved from any personal responsibility, and 100% of the solution rests in the hands of our employers. And this is where I'm calling BS. We need to take and remain in charge of stewarding our own happiness, taking hold of our own fate. The United States is the third largest workforce and the largest economy on the planet. Yet more and more, Gallup's results are camouflaging our real illness. Our disengagement is a byproduct of an undiagnosed infection of hopelessness. Closer to home, you and I know that workplace stress is hurting us, not just the places we work. Our sense of purpose, social relationships, financial security, relationships to our communities, and physical health are all negatively affected. Some of us have forgotten that work is where we create art. Some of us have resigned ourselves to maintaining a passing grade, keeping the job, but we limit our efforts to merely delivering C-minus output, just enough to avoid getting fired. Friends, what the hell are we doing here? We cannot allow this to continue. We are ultimately responsible for our happiness, our engagement, and receiving the recognition we desire. If you're stuck on the treadmill of blame, apathy, and numb indifference, then I can help. I've got a tough pill for you to swallow, and I mentioned it earlier when discussing evil plans. Here it is. Help is not on the way. No one is coming to save you, least of all corporate America. And your company? It isn't going to change. But guess what? You can. Don't think it's possible or that it will really make any difference? Look at this silver lining in the Gallup data. 1 out of 3 employees actually enjoys going to work, gets promoted, and is challenged, rewarded, and empowered to craft a fulfilling career and balanced life. They do exist. Maybe you know one of the hopeful and empowered. Side note to the happy one-third who are here with us. Hi there. I'm glad you're searching for new strategies to continually advance your career and solidifying a sustainable position of career strength and healthy work-life balance. Well done. As you probably know, our friends in the Gallup, I'm not sure how I can do this again tomorrow, majority, need help. I flirted with becoming one of them until I discovered this unconventional path of renovating my career from the inside out. You give us a glimmer of hope that things can be different. And ultimately, we want to thrive as part of the happy one-third like you. That's the space where we're headed in this book. And together, we will study life-giving, career-advancing behaviors and beliefs required for a joy-filled, sustainable career. And by the way, I'm confident that even though you're rocking your gig, you still need help creating an expanded toolbox of practices to go the distance. Become a heretic. Here's the deal. Everyone loves elements of their job, but the overall picture...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.